Assalamu alaikum. I'm hoping to do a little presentation just on the Hajj. I had wanted to just discuss, since now the pilgrims, some of them I've been contacting them and wishing them what we say a Hajj Mabrur, an accepted pilgrimage or accepted Hajj. So I just wanted to discuss briefly what Muslims will be going through the pilgrimage as they're heading right now from all over the world, answering the call of that Prophet Abraham made thousands of years ago. So, first, let me discuss what does Hajj or pilgrimage mean. It's one of the five pillars of Islam. The other four are testimony of faith, or we say shahada, of salah, or obligatory five daily prayers, the zakat, or the purification of wealth, the sawm, or the obligatory fasting in the month of Ramadan. So Hajj is also one of the five pillars, and it's the last in the series of pillars. Hajj means really to make a pilgrimage to Mecca and the surrounding area, and to participate in certain rites and acts of worship, both in Mecca and the nearby places. Myself, I went in the year 2014. As I had mentioned, I had tried more than one time to go in with various different groups, and it was not successful. I tried to argue with the Saudi embassy, and that did not prove successful. Tried to get through with some family members, and that didn't prove to be successful. But what it's important to understand, it's you make an intention, you make an effort, but you wait really for the invitation. As we go to the pilgrimage, it's important to understand that the prayers are acts of worship, where the soul, mind, and body all participate in the worship. So as we're going there, you have to have some moment where you can just reflect on that whole journey that you're going to be taking to Mecca. It's not, you don't want to sort of rush and just get everything ready and move. So I've been like preparing myself year after year, but once you get there, the crowd is so overwhelming. For me, myself, it's like, I gave this presentation that I'm giving right now in 2013. I took classes on Hajj, but when I went there, I nearly forgot like everything, all the rituals and all the things I wrote down, because it's just so overwhelming in terms of all the physical things that you have to partake in. So it's good to have some notes. Looking back, I had them like in a notebook type fashion, and you're just so overwhelmed. I would encourage you all to have index cards instead, as you're going through every single journey from one place to the next. Have an index card for each place. Well, you know, and include on that index card what you need in terms of prayers or supplications to make. What are some of the integrals or conditions that you need to fulfill for that particular act of worship? So include everything that you need in terms of your soul, your body, that needs to engage in for that particular place, for that particular act of worship, and put it on an index card so that you can go from one index card to the next, instead of having to go research through all your notes and the book. And that can be just a little bit overwhelming. Again, the Hajj or the pilgrimage, every Muslim who is able to perform the pilgrimage, both financially as well as physically, should partake in it. Once in their lifetime is what is required. You can do more, but that is optional. I hope to go again. I was hoping to go with my daughter. It did not work out because she needed a mahram, and I was not able to fulfill that requirement for her. So hopefully in the future, though, I hope to go again and maybe also have my daughter join me as well. Pilgrimage there too is a duty men owe to God, those who can afford the journey, but if any deny faith, Allah stands not in need of any of his servants. What is the purpose of Hajj? One thing, it reconnects us to God. And the word Eid that we celebrate, the holiday that we celebrate after Hajj as well as after Ramadan, comes from the word to reconnect. And just like Eid al-Fitr after Ramadan as well as Hajj, it's really a reconnection to God. The world is such that it disconnects humanity from God. It disconnects humanity from their obligations, from their duties, from community, from family. But the whole purpose of that really is just to reconnect to oneself, reconnect to God, and reconnect to the people that came before us that have built, for example, the very first house of worship. To reconnect by going to Hajj, we reconnect to the story of Adam and Eve, who first met at Mount Arafat in the Arabian Peninsula. We reconnect to Prophet Abraham, who made the call for Hajj on Mount Arafat. Mount Arafat is a major part of the pilgrimage rites. It reminds us of our responsibility and our mission on earth. It helps us to prepare ourselves and remind us of our end and on the Day of Judgment, because it will be very similar on the Day of Judgment, how we will be coming together, being accountable before God for our actions and our deeds. It's practical training in obedience and submission to God, and it's practical manifestation of the Islamic principles of brotherhood as well as equality before God. What is the relationship of Hajj with Prophet Abraham? Prophet Abraham is one of the five resolute prophets, peace and blessings upon them all. The other four are Prophet Noah, Moses, Jesus, and Prophet Muhammad. Again, peace and blessings upon them all. God promised to bless people through Abraham and to give him a great lineage of prophets through his descendants. The first son of Prophet Abraham, according to Islamic tradition, was Prophet Ismail, who dwelled in Arabia, and from his descendants came the last of all of the prophets, which is Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. The second son of Prophet Abraham was Isaac, peace and blessings upon him, who dwelled in Palestine, and in his descendants came all of the Israelite prophets, ending with Jesus, upon them all, peace and blessing. In the Islamic tradition, it says that when Ismail was a small boy, the only son at the time, God gave Abraham the command to take his only son and his mother Hagar and take them to the wilderness of Paran, which is now known as Mecca. At that time, Paran was a desolate place with no plantation, people, or settlements. In the Quran, when Abraham took Hagar, Ismail, to Paran, she asked him, "Where are you leaving us in this desolate place, with nobody or companion?" She repeated this question many times and he did not reply. Then she asked him, "Abraham, did God ordain you to do this?" And he said, "Yes." She replied, "In all faith and submission to God, if God ordained this, then he will not get us lost." In the desert, Hagar ran out of water. So she started running between two hills. And one of the acts of worship that Muslims will perform when they go to Mecca is called the Safa and Marwa, the Sia. And so she started running between these two hills called Safa and Marwa, which still exist in Mecca, in search for water. So we will also try to follow in her footsteps, running from, or walking as we did. Some people ran slowly from Safa to Marwa, back and forth, seven times, following in her footsteps, as a sign of the place that she has with God. So now everybody, all Muslims will not only try to reconnect to Prophet Abraham, but they'll also reconnect to his wife Hagar, and to just try to reflect in soul on her journey that she had to partake in the desert with just a child, no help, one around her, no food, nothing, going from one hill to the next hill, one hill to the next hill, back and forth seven times in search just for water. None of us really probably have to ever endure that in real life, but it helps us to, as we're going there, just take a moment and to reflect on the journey she had to take and how that journey helps to connect, by connecting to her, also connect us to God and the strength that she had and the faith that she had and the certainty that she had with God. Having lost all hope in finding water and having only faith in God, miraculously she checked and found that while her son was crying and kicking the ground with his heels, a fountain or spring of water gushed from under his feet. That well is called Zamzam and is over 3,000 years old. Once water was available in the desert, people began to settle around it, and thus grew the holy city of Mecca. So first she was alone without any help, and then she was able to find, God was able to bring out a well from underneath her. So her reliance was on God, because she, after running seven times back and forth, now she reached a point, as one scholar said, people just make dua to God, but they don't make the effort to fulfill, or what is the word I'm trying to think of here? They don't make the exerted effort to use up all of what they, God has given them, before they take their prayer to God. So it's like the means could be right before you or next to you, and people misunderstand the thing of go pray to God, and you don't fulfill or partake of those means, you're making a dua or a prayer to God, but the means are right there. In her case, she had no means. Her Abraham wasn't there. There were no people there. There was no water there. And so she ran back and forth, back and forth. So that's called the dua of al-muttar. Dua al-muttar is when there are no means before you. There are no means. Everything within your power, everything within your capacity that you hold, you have put to use. Now, your need. So you can, for example, have, just to give you an example, you can't have, for example, like money in the bank and then make dua to God saying, oh, give me this to feed my kids. Well, you have money in the bank. You're not someone in need. Or you have health and you're refusing to work, and then you're saying, you know, I'm going to pray to God. This is a prayer of need. Well, you have health. You know, you should go and get it and work. So the prayer of need is when you exert and you put in everything that God has given you within your power and within your hands and within your health. You put all of that, you exert it to the very max, and now you find that you're not able to accomplish or find what is that is your basic need. Then you have reached that point spiritually of dua al-muttar. And now you're able to witness and experience then God responding to you, because you're in that spiritual state. It's not just a physical state. You're in that spiritual state. So you're not just making a prayer of just the lips or just words. It's really coming from the very depth of your soul to God, and that very depth which is experiencing that I have absolutely no way of getting out of this without your help. So now you witness that power and you witness that help. So she witnessed the water gushing forth, and she witnessed people. Here she was alone, her and her son in the desert, now with certainty that she was able to witness with her own eyes and her own being, people now coming slowly around her in the holy city of Mecca, and a city started to slowly surround her. You might see people started to build a city because they were also looking for water, and they were travelers and Bedouins and nomads, probably like the desert people. So they began to settle, and now she started to be now surrounded by a community. Prophet Abraham visited his wife and Ishmael. The first was the case when Abraham went to Mecca and built the first house of worship, which we say the Kaaba, the holy shrine that still exists in Mecca, that we go around it when we're in the pilgrimage. The first house on earth built for worship, and it's the what it's built in the worship of one God, and he built it with his help of his son Ishmael. The second incident was where Abraham went to Mecca. And this was a story of the sacrifice when God commanded Abraham to sacrifice Ishmael. So we try to fulfill both of these acts. One is that we went around the house, the very first house of worship. And the second incident where we do try to, not physically with our own hands, but we will, for example, entrust somebody to sacrifice an animal. And then we give, there's certain like rituals of the animal, like a certain part goes to family and friends, and a good part of it then goes also to the poor. So we have also been trying to fulfill both of these requirements. The sacrifice of Ishmael, Abraham saw in a dream that he was sacrificing his first and only son, Ishmael. When Abraham consulted Ishmael, Ishmael showed a great deal of faith in God and obedience to his father and simply responded that if God had ordained him to do so, then he should do it. Abraham took his son Ishmael to Mina near Mecca for sacrifice. The angel gave Abraham a ram instead. When people finish their pilgrimage, they go to Mina and they slaughter the rams. Now, we did not do that with our own hands. There are still people that do it. What I did in my own case is I have an organization that I, and some people that I know. And so I try to give money to those organizations. They will do it. And then you say to give it to the poor. And so that's what I do. When I'm here locally, I try to do it where I give some, to organizations that will do it for people who are refugees or to the poor, but I also make just one sacrifice here locally to give it to and then spread it out through family and friends. It's a way of giving thanks to God for saving Prophet Ishmael and order him to become the grandfather of the last of God's prophets, Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him all. So again, that reconnection, now we're reconnecting to Ishmael through this sacrifice, we're reconnecting to Prophet Abraham, but we're also reconnecting to Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, because Ishmael as well as Abraham are the fathers of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. The sacrifice, just from the Quran, he said, I will go to my Lord, he will surely guide me. Oh my Lord, grant me a righteous son. So we gave him the good news of a boy ready to suffer. He's like someone who's very forbearing, Prophet Ishmael. Then when the son reached the age of serious work with him, he said, oh my son, I see in vision that I offer thee in sacrifice. Now see what is thy view. The son said, oh my father, do as thou art commanded. Thou wilt find me, if Allah so wills, one practicing patience and constancy. When they had both submitted their wills to God and he had laid him prostrate on his forehead for sacrifice, we called out to him, O Abraham, thou hast already fulfilled the vision. Thus indeed do we reward those who do right, for this was obviously a trial, and we ransomed him with a momentous sacrifice. And we left this blessing for him among generations to come in later times. Peace and salutation to Abraham. Thus indeed do we reward those who do right, for he was one of our believing servants, and we gave him the good news of Isaac. It's after Ishmael as a way of fulfilling his sacrifice or his test. He was now also rewarded with another son, one of the righteous. And we blessed him and Isaac, but of their progeny are some that do right and some that obviously do wrong to their own souls. Just because we are from the progeny of, for example, Prophet Ishmael or even Prophet Isaac, you know, it doesn't mean that we've become prophets ourselves, or saints, so we still also have to fulfill by reconnecting to God and being accountable, like we said about the Mount Arafat. We also are accountable to do right. We don't get a special privilege just because we are of their progeny. We have to keep that in mind, that we also have to fulfill in mind, body, and soul what the prophets have done by acting upon that. The building of the Kaaba. And remember, Abraham and Ishmael raised the foundations of the house with this prayer: Our Lord, accept this service from us, for thou art the all-hearing, the all-knowing. Our Lord, make us Muslims bound to thy will, and of our progeny a people Muslim bound to thy will, and show us our place for the celebration of due rites, and turn unto us in mercy, for thou art the oft-returning, most merciful. So not only do we have to act and be accountable for our action, but we should also seek acceptance of those actions. And we see this also again when we reconnect to the prophets after every action that they have done for God. They don't assume that it was accepted, but they actually turn in gratitude to God, and then they also turn in prayer to God, asking for that service or that action that they have done, for it to be accepted, and asking for mercy, and asking for God's forgiveness. The call. Prophet Abraham pleaded, "Oh God," you know, he was asked to make a call to all of humankind, not just the people in that small building community in Mecca, but to all humankind, to call them to Hajj, or to call them to the pilgrimage. So Prophet Abraham had said, "How shall I, my voice, reach all of humankind?" And God had told him that it's his duty was only to make the call, and that it was up to God to make it heard by people. Prophet Abraham then climbed Mount Arafat, and as loud as he could, he yelled, "O people, verily God has prescribed Hajj for you, so perform it." Again, just like Hajar, his prophet's wife, went ahead and witnessed with certainty how the water gushed forth in a community. Here she was alone in the desert, started to slowly build around her, that built certainty within her. Likewise with Prophet Abraham, here he's standing up, speaking in the desert, calling all of humankind. And we're witnessing year after year, year after year, people from all over the world answering that call. So that's also a moment for reflection for us to see how that builds certainty in these believers. That again, they fulfilled the impossible tasks. They stood up without seeing with their own perception, not relying on their own mind, but just following God's orders. And then they were able to see with certainty how humanity was coming forth from all over the world answering the call. So it was God's mission to bring them, but he had to make the call. So when the pilgrims come from all walks of life and all parts of the world, they're following the steps of their father in faith, Prophet Abraham, in their devotion to God. The journey to the holy city is a reminder for us that our entire life is nothing but a journey. Our life is a journey that we may be long or short, only God knows. We have to realize that we're passing through a journey in our life that has an end, and our ultimate destiny is to go back to God and stand accountable for our lives. This is a quote that I got from Jamal Badawi's commentary on Hajj. So I thought it was a nice quote just to help us, because it is a reflective type of journey. And if you try to take a time out to reflect on that journey, it helps. I actually did this, like I said, presentation in 2013, the year before. So it helps to try to prepare yourself for the journey, not just when you're going, but even before you go, just, you know, taking, like I said, classes, trying to even do a presentation or something, because once you get there, it does become very taxing and it's very difficult to really take a moment then to try to reflect on it. So try to do it now, even if you're not going to Hajj or the pilgrimage, pretend you are. And do what I do, try to pretend you're going over there, do a presentation, and just try to go through one step at a time, take a moment, reflect on, as the pilgrims are going there, what are they doing, why, what are some of the rituals, try to reconnect to the prophets, reconnect to Hajar, reconnect to Ismail, try to take a moment and reconnect to God and those who are connected to God. Answering the call. A week from the eighth day of the month of Dhul-Hijjah, this is the month of when pilgrimage happens, to the 13th day, that's really the day that they consider to be the days of Hajj. The month of Dhul-Hijjah is the 12th month in the Islamic lunar calendar. Based on the moon, it's about 11 days shorter than the solar year, so every year it's like 11 days before. So next year, like right now, people are going to Hajj. Next year, they'll be going August 10th or August even 9th. So every year, it's like 11 days before or shorter. You will see. It's not the exact same time that we go to Hajj every single time because it follows a lunar calendar. It starts with the state of what we say is ihram, which is a state of intention and performance of special rites that mark the beginning of the pilgrimage. It begins in a specified location called the Mawaqit, ranges from 100 to 500 kilometers outside of Mecca. We had to make our intention in the plane because we ended up landing, and before we were able to land in that area of Mawaqit, so we had to make our intention there. I think it was in New York, we made our intention and we just prepared ourselves in our state of ihram as we were there. Some people start preparing themselves in the airplane. So some people do start in the plane to go to Jeddah, which is far enough for them to begin after arriving. The pilgrim removes his or her worldly clothes and dons for the man. You could see how from the picture, they don a pilgrim's garb of two seamless white sheets. Women pilgrims, now we still continue to wear what we wear. It doesn't have to be white sheets. Can be any simple modest clothes. It just still follows the guidelines of hijab. Answering the call, usually people will on the plane or as they're going there, they start making this prayer. In Arabic, it's labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, innal hamda wal ni'ma laka wal mulk la sharika lak. Here I am, O Allah, or here I am, O God, here I am, you have no partner, here I am, truly yours is all praise, all goodness and all sovereignty, and you have no partner. So the response to the call of God and to the call made 3,000 years ago, made by Abraham, that everybody should sanctify and purify this house and use it for the worship of the one true God. Just to give you a little map of what it looks like when we are there in Saudi Arabia. We arrived, again, here's where you will start to make the intention. You come in here, this is the area of Mecca. Some people came and they started off with Medina and then they went and they came into Mecca. So there are certain times where you have to be in a particular place. The Mina or the encampment, here's where we go to slowly into the plain of Arafat, which is right here where we're going to the point, again, to reconnect to what Prophet Abraham standing up on Mount of Arafat. That's a very important part of the pilgrimage. We also go to Muzdalifah, where we had to, some people slept overnight, and I only stayed up till midnight or a little past midnight, and then I went back to the Mina, where was the encampment. So if you're able to stay towards all the way till Fajr, you can stay, but they sleep outside, and it helps you to maybe reflect on people who are homeless and sleep outside. But we had to sleep actually outside. It was again extremely crowded. Being an introvert myself, the hardest part of the Hajj was just the crowds. I found it extremely physically and mentally draining. Just, you know, there's like a certain amount of time just that you can handle crowds, and after a while you feel like your body's about to collapse. So for me, if you're an introvert, because they tell you and they prepare you to walk before you go to Hajj, but they don't tell you there's a major crowd congestion over there. And if you're an introvert, you may want to keep in mind it's tremendously crowded over there, and you're going to be overwhelmed. And so you want to probably reflect on that part as a lot, and just prepare yourself for being drained, physically as well as mentally, in all of the different rituals that you have to fulfill. Answering the call. We began our first ritual. Again, we started our intention, then we landed in the hotel, and then we tried to do, it's not required, but we tried to do what is called small pilgrimage or umrah. And it begins with doing like circling the Kaaba. This is the very first house of worship. It's just like a mosque, you might think of it. It's just the very first house of worship for God. But people cannot all fit in here. What they do is they just go around it. Supposed to be a unity of purpose. So you circle it 7 times on one's left side, the circle starting at the corner in the Kaaba where the black stone is housed. While making the rounds, one prays earnestly to God for guidance, support in one's life, and for salvation in the hereafter. So we began, we landed in the hotel. Once we arrived in the hotel, we took a small shower, then we all met in the lobby. And we went with our guide, and he took us, and we went and circled the Kaaba 7 times. After the pilgrim finishes circling the Kaaba, he goes to a place, the station of Abraham, which is near the Kaaba. And currently, this spot is surrounded by a small glass structure. The spot contains the footprint of Prophet Abraham, where he was building the Kaaba. Apparently, the ground was moist, and then it dried. But we went just to see it. Some people take a moment and they they say 2 rak'at, like they do two form like they do two prostrations of worship. So and it's just a way of gratitude. Again, you're there to reconnect. So there's a station there specifically. It's called the Station of Abraham. Some people do not partake in that. Some people will partake in that. They'll stop right there and they will do 2 cycles of prayer and as a way of thank you to God. The pilgrim then goes to a nearby. After we do the circling of the Kaaba, one of the rituals that we perform is called the Safa and Marwa or the Sa'i. So the pilgrim will go to a nearby place called Safa and Marwa, where there are 2 small hills about 1/4 mile apart. The pilgrim is supposed to go from one to the other 7 times, one way from one hill to the other. And it's very close to where the Kaaba is. You just go from one to the next, 7 times. We used to stop at each head, like we'd stop here, we'd make prayers, we'd come to Safa and we'd make prayers, we'd go here, we'd make prayers, we'd come here, we'd make prayers. So you do that like 7 times. Right now, again, if you're connecting to Hajar, she was doing it when it was outside. Right now it's done inside. It's air conditioned, so it's like they have it all encamped inside. It's very air conditioned. People walk without even slippers or anything. It's very cool, very clean, very, very nice. We didn't have a hard time. When she did it, of course, it was in the desert. It was dark outside. There wasn't water like there. There was water all over the place while we were doing the sa'i. We would stop. There was Zamzam water here. There was Zamzam water sideline here. So just to kind of stop and reflect on, we're just doing the physical part, but as we're doing it, to reflect on when she did it, there was no water, there was no air-conditioned area, there was no ease that we're going to be experiencing while doing it, when she herself had did it, looked searching for water. On the eighth day of Dhul Hijjah, pilgrims leave Mecca and camp at a nearby place called Mina. So we came here in a camp place, and we were waiting for going to Arafah, which was next. One of the difficulties that we faced here, most of the tents were air-conditioned, but our tent, for whatever reason, that we had problems with the air conditioning. It failed on us, so it was extremely hot. It was very, very hot in that area. And we went at a time which was, I think, probably the most warmest time is probably June or July. I mean, July and August. So I guess it's still not the worst temps that you could face in Saudi Arabia, but it was extremely, extremely hot. So just to keep in mind that if you have problems with heat, you may want to think about that. I know some people did. I remember when I was talking to people, they faced heat exhaustion. They found it just really, really difficult to stay up to fulfill the acts of worship because of the intensity of the heat in the area. The day of Arafat, that's after when we camp in Mina, we didn't really go too far. We didn't go to the mountain area. What they did is, just because you cannot fit all the millions of people over here. Some people are able to make it here, but we had like a nearby area where people would just be in the camps around the Mount of Arafat. And it's supposed to be the same, where you take that moment and the pilgrims will move to where that, around that area, and they will just use that whole rest of the day one-on-one with God, it should be, and they'll just make a lot of prayers for forgiveness and a lot of prayers for themselves and others, seeking God's grace, seeking God's forgiveness, whatever they had came to, they would seek it from God in that time. The pilgrims then move and camp at Muzdalifah, and after Arafat, that's where we went, which is a site between Mina and Arafat. It's highly recommended for Muslims around the world to fast on that day of Arafat and spiritual union with the pilgrims who are standing on the plain. So we ourselves were not asked to fast, but like, for example, this year or other years, if you're not going to the pilgrim or to the Hajj, it would be optional for you or recommended for you to fast, and you would get your sins of this year and the previous year forgiven. So this is just something to keep in mind as we're facing the coming days. But like I said, when we go to Muzdalifah, you camp outside and people will sleep outside. Some will stay till like past midnight, and then some stayed the entire time. For me, it was just the crowd was just too much. I don't think I could handle crowds during the day, crowds during the night. I stayed until a little past midnight. People were just sort of camping outside. Not that they were like cooking or anything, but it was extremely crowded, and just something to keep in mind when you're going there. Answering the call, the pilgrims returned to Mina. And on our way back from Muzdalifah, we stopped at a place called the Jamarat. And so our very first stop from there, we're going right back again to Mina where we were before, but we stop in the middle, and then there's a place where you throw stones. And these really symbolize that Satan tried to turn Prophet Abraham from worshiping God and from fulfilling what God asked him to do in his vision. And so he threw the stones as a way to push Satan away and to continue with his to fulfill what he saw in his vision. So throwing the stones at the stone pillars. So you do it three times, set in separate different times. So we did it. The first time I came right after Muzdalifah, I would stand right there, and I did it three times. And then we had to make two separate visits. So it's three visits, and each visit you do it three times. You just throw the stones three times, and then you head back. you're done with fulfilling that. After you answer the call, one of the rituals that you will do is one should cut a little bit of their hair to symbolize the end of most of the restrictions of ihram. So after a certain number of restrictions are fulfilled and a certain number of rituals are fulfilled, then people will shave their heads for the men. For the women, you usually will just cut a small little bit of hair, depending from a very small little bit of hair that you will just after you fulfill the rituals. After we do that, then we continue and we try to do more circling of the Kaaba. So there's many times that we have to circle. We circle it for the Umrah, we said, when we're starting the small pilgrimage, but we also, when we're starting the Hajj, circling called Ifal, which is, and then we also do, when we're about to end the Hajj, we'll be doing the circling of, as a way of saying a farewell or a goodbye. Then the pilgrim sacrifices, we said a sheep, but like I said, if you have organizations that you work with, usually they will take money and they will do the sacrifice for you. They will give the meat to people who are poor and in need of that meat. When you fulfill all of the requirements and the rituals, then what we have is called the Eid al-Adha, or the Festival of Sacrifice. It's a major religious holiday for Muslims. Eid al-Adha occurs on the 10th day of the Hijjah. It is the celebration which begins with a special prayer in the morning, followed by a sermon. And the theme of the Eid is Abraham's example of unconditional surrender and love to God. And afterwards, or on the following weekend, families or communities, usually here in the Twin Cities or Minnesota, probably in other areas, it won't be on the following weekend, it'll be in that same week. But just due to work and school, but the way it works usually for Muslims who are minorities in other areas, is they will find when it's more convenient, they will try to get together with family and communities and hold celebrations, food, games, and gifts for children. After we finished our major rituals and we did farewell to the Kaaba, then we went to Medina, which is the mosque for Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. And so we went and visited that area. It's not required or part of Hajj, but we did go and visit it, and we visited the nearby areas, some nearby places as well. Something you may want to consider about visitation for the places that are close and nearby. So I just wanted to give a brief little information for people about what Muslims will be experiencing during the pilgrimage. And you may want to find the scholar that you trust and ask the more detailed question and answers about all the different rituals that you have to partake while you're going on a pilgrimage, if you need those questions answered. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.